API provides creators with the ability to build and share rich media applications that, until recently, were only possible in professional digital audio tools like SuperCollider or Apple Logic. Let's first listen on the web to this glitch example available at purescript-wags-atari-speaks.surge.sh. The web can also do some heavy lifting with synthesis. For example, listen to this glistening eerie pad at mikesaul.github.io/synthlib. And finally, get your microphones ready and check out this link, mikesaul.github.io/feedback. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on the WebAudio API. What all of these examples have in common is that they were all created using a technique called Functional Reactive Programming, or FRP. In this video, I'm going to talk more about FRP as well as a related concept called a stream. I'll show you how FRP and streams provide a rich toolset for working with web audio. Now, from a consumer's perspective, the Web Audio API is nothing more than a graph. The graph has resources like oscillators, filters, and gain nodes, and there are certain rules about what can be connected to what, but at the end of the day, it's just a graph. Now, let's listen to the output of a web audio graph, and we'll look at the output in a web audio inspector. Now, even though this graph looks static, don't let that fool you. It's actually quite dynamic, and there's lots of changes happening on the inside of it. For example, let's zoom in on a single gain node and see how it's changing over time. One way to think about this graph is that it's not descriptive, but rather prescriptive, meaning we can give a rendering engine a graph, say that the graph is going to change over time, like perhaps 50 times a second, and then sample it in order to create the audio. Now, if we sample at that rate of 50 times a second or greater, we can capture enough nuances to communicate vivid information, a whole soundscape to listeners' ears. Sampling is the bread and butter operation of the technique that I talked about called functional reactive programming. In FRP, there's actually a data type called the behavior that represents the state of some computational world. Now, in our case, the behavior is the state of the web audio graph. It's a graph behavior. Behaviors in functional reactive programming are then sampled based on some external stimulus. The stimulus can be user-initiated, like a mouse click, or predefined, like a polling loop. Let's look at the example that we just heard and see how it's put together in PureScript using a library called purescript-wags. Here in the library, we actually use something called a type, which is a description of the graph that's not executed at runtime, but executed at compile time in order to show what nodes are in the graph and how they connect to each other. Then, at runtime, these nodes are connected to each other very efficiently, and moreover, they're sampled over time based on certain external stimuli, the most common one being the time of the audio clock, but there are others as well that we'll see in a little bit. This sampling is all performed under the hood. We write the graph quite declaratively, meaning we declare what goes into it, and then we declare how it changes over time, without specifying how nodes are hooked up to each other, exactly how we're going to change them. Now, this distinction of declarative versus imperative programming is crucial in functional programming in general. In more imperative languages, like JavaScript or TypeScript, we spend a lot of time telling the language how to connect objects and in what order. In my opinion, this has two pitfalls. It requires a lot of code to be written to be productive, and it's also the source of many subtle errors, like calling a function with incorrect input, or forgetting to call a function, or even calling functions in the wrong order. Functional reactive programming, and in general functional programming, on the other hand, makes declarations like the one you see on the screen about how the world should look. For example, this scene type shows how things are connected together. And then in the piece, there's this statement called iLoop that describes the type of loop that's happening over time and that you hear in the example. All of the creating, connecting, and changing that happens that makes the WebAudio API dynamic is the result of manipulations done at the low level, either with library purescript-wags or other libraries in purescript. This idea of trickling down from declarations to more subtle declarations about how the world works and eventually turning it into a list of imperative instructions, like an assembly language that's interpreted by JavaScript or WebAssembly or any lower level language, is really at the heart of functional programming and provides programmers with powerful abstractions that they could use to describe the outcome they wish to achieve. In a relatively terse format, we're already able to build a rich web audio application. And one important thing to note is that there's no domain-specific language. This is a vanilla PureScript program, which means the power of the whole language is at our disposal. So we heard a graph that's static, but now let's hear a graph that, while its nodes don't change, will have some dynamism in its input, or more dynamism in the clock. Specifically, that dynamism is going to come from our friend the mouse. So the other important concept in functional reactive programming is called the event. Unlike behaviors, events are discrete functions of time. That means that whereas a behavior, like the web audio graph that we saw, can be sampled at any time, events are ephemeral and must be dealt with immediately. As I mentioned, one common event is a mouse click. So let's see how we can capture mouse down events using PureScript WAGs. In this example, we're going to take the first few chords of John Coltrane's Giant Step and change them, Giant Steps, and change them using the mouse. Slowly and fast. Quite reactive, isn't it? And the interesting thing is that when you look at the code that's used to create this, it's just as declarative as the previous example. Now, for those of you that are used to web programming, you know that when there's something like a mouse, a lot of times there are handlers and asynchronous event handling and race conditions, and it can get pretty difficult pretty quick. But the nice thing about the functional reactive programming paradigm is that you create a language to describe what type of events you'll be ingesting. In this case, we're either starting the example or we have a mouse down event. And then we just check. So for example, in here, if the event bus is active, and if the trigger is mouse down, then we change it. Otherwise, we stay the same. And again, in this terse if statement, we're able to capture all the dynamism of the example that you just heard. Now, this technique can be extended to lots of different events, including MIDI events and live coding. So in conclusion, the techniques that I've used here, which all fall under the umbrella of something called functional reactive programming using existential types, provides a rich, expressive, and type-safe framework for creating interactive web audio applications. In this presentation, we've seen how they can be used to create synthetic sounds, musical instruments, and some pretty dynamic soundscapes. Languages like PureScript, Haskell, Idris, and Agda have proven to be great partners in the creative journey to create this type of music. And the ability to bring these concepts to the web represents, in my opinion, an unprecedented opportunity to share works in a way we've never done before. I very much hope you get a chance to experiment with these ideas, and I'm excited to hear where they lead you. Take care.